नमस्ते टू ऑल. आई एम गोइंग टू टॉक ऑन सक्सेशन एंड इनहेरिटेंस. नाउ व्हेन वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट सक्सेशन एंड इनहेरिटेंस, इट प्राइमरली फॉल्स अंडर फैमिली लॉज और द पर्सनल लॉज. और बिकॉज इट इज कंसर्निंग फैमिली लॉ और पर्सनल लॉ, द लॉ ऑफ सक्सेशन एंड इनहेरिटेंस इज डिफरेंट अकॉर्डिंग टू द religion that a person belongs. That is the law in India. We have uniform criminal code, but then we do not have uniform civil code. What it means is, when a person commits a crime, irrespective of which religion he belongs to, he is punished and dealt with by the same law. On the contrary, when it comes to family laws, we don't have uniform civil code, and hence the person will be dealt under according to his personal laws, that is the law applicable to his religion. Those major distinctions and how the law applies will be dealt in separate sections. Initially, we need to understand what is succession and inheritance. Though these words appear to be different, for the purpose of law, they are interchangeably used to mean the same. One idea could be succession. The primary meaning of succession is to succeed to one's office, that is, one after the other. When we apply the English meaning of succession or to succeed, it could be to an office or to property. It could be when a person is alive also. Whereas inheritance predominantly applies when a person dies and to whom his property goes. Nevertheless, the words succession and inheritance are interchangeably used here in terms of law. We have terms being used as inheritance of coparcenary property or inheritance under the Hindu law of Mitakshara and Dayabhaga. Then we have the Indian Succession Act, the Hindu Succession Act. So they are interchangeably used, and for the purpose of basic understanding, they both more or less mean the same, whether it is succession or inheritance. Now, when we are talking about succession or inheritance, basically there are two types: testamentary succession and non-testamentary succession, or intestate succession. What it means is testament. Testament means what is written. That is, testamentary means where there is a will. When a person who has died has written a will, then the property will be distributed after his death according to his will. Now, in law, we don't use the word distributed. We use the word devolve. The property will devolve on the persons to whom the property has been willed. That is testamentary succession. Non-testamentary succession means when a person dies without writing a will. That is also known as intestate succession. So here again, depending on whether there is a will or the person has not written a will, the devolution of property, that is inheritance or succession, will differ even among the various laws. So you have laws of testamentary succession and non-testamentary succession in Hindu law. You have testamentary succession and non-testamentary succession among Muslims. You have testamentary succession and non-testamentary succession among others like Christians and Parsis. Now, when we are talking about succession or inheritance of property in terms of when a person dies and his property goes to his relatives or to whom he has written a will, then we are necessarily talking about the existence of a property. If a person who has died does not have any property, then the question of succession or inheritance of property does not arise, because there is no property to succeed or there is no property to inherit. So predominantly there must be property. property could be either movable property or immovable property. When we are talking about immovable property, we are talking about sites, houses, buildings, lands, and such type. Movable property could be anything which is capable of being moved, that is the cars, vehicles, tools, or jewels, or even shares. These are referred to as movable property. So both movable property and immovable property can be inherited or succeeded according to the laws applicable to them. So once property is there and once a person has died, then we have to see what law will be applicable. The law that is applicable in terms of succession or inheritance will be the law to which the person to the religion to which the person belonged. So it depends on his personal law. If he is a Hindu, then Hindu law of succession will apply. If he is a Muslim, then Muslim law of succession will apply. Accordingly, Christian law and Parsi's law and others. One remarkable difference between Hindus and others in terms of property is, among Hindus, there is a special kind of property called as coparsonary property. Though in law we are very clear with regard to what is coparsonary property, however, in among the general public, there is a lot of misconception and doubts regarding what is coparsonary property. More so because it is being portrayed in a different way because of movies. Now, when I'm talking about coparsonary property, I'm talking about ancestral property. We have always heard that ancestral property, a grandson has right over his grandfather's property. So a father cannot sell his father's property without giving it to his son. Now let's see whether how far that is true and what is the position of law. Now for the purpose of succession and inheritance in Hindu law, the property could be ancestral property or self-earned property. Now, self-earned property means, as the name suggests, a property which has been earned by a person during his lifetime out of his money. This is the basic meaning, and this is the meaning that everybody understands, that what self-earned property means. However, in law, there is a different connotation to the concept of self-earned property. Except for ancestral property, all others are self-earned property. So the definition or meaning of ancestral property becomes important. And secondly, the concept of self-earned property does not limit only to those properties which are earned by the person during his lifetime. Now, what is this ancestral property? Ancestral property does not mean merely property received from your father, which you have received, and which your son or your children claim right over it, telling that you don't have a right to dispose it of according to your wish. This is what usually is shown in the movies, and people have an understanding of what is shown in the movies and over normal talks, but this is not true. Ancestral property means coparsonary property, or what is known as property of the Hindu undivided family. Again, this concept of Hindu undivided family is very peculiar to under the Hindu law, wherein there is joint family property. And these are all connected terms: joint family property, coparsonary property, Hindu undivided family, ancestral property. These are all terms which are interconnected. So what in common understanding is ancestral property is either the property of a Hindu undivided family is ancestral property, or when property has been received by a person for three generations, and that person must be the fourth generation, without any division. Your father, your grandfather, and great-grandfather. So great-grandfather's property, whatever great-grandfather had, grandfather received, received by your father and you have received it, and it has to be undivided. That is, there must not be any division, and without any division, property has been coming from three generations. That is referred to as ancestral property. And only when such a condition is met, then your son or your children have an absolute right wherein you cannot dispose of the property according to your whims and fancies, but then they get an automatic right. If it is not an ancestral property, then all other kinds of property becomes self-earned property. For example, as I already said, the property that you actually earn and buy is self-earned property. Secondly, the property that is gifted to you by anyone is your self-earned property. The property that comes to you by succession or inheritance from your father or any other relative after division of that property is, for the purpose of law, self-earned property. And any other kind of property which you receive by whatever means, either by a court decision or by release or any other way which you get, it could be a woman's stridana, that is property given to a woman under Hindu law by virtue of her marriage. All these are considered as self-earned property. Now, if it is a self-earned property, then you have absolute right over it and you can deal with the property as you may like. You may gift it to whomever you want, you may sell it to whomever you want in your lifetime, or you may write a will with regard to those properties which will come into effect after your death. However, if it is an ancestral property or a Hindu undivided family, you don't have absolute right over the property. You are only a co-partner, or you are only a person who also has a share. Even if you are the head of the family, and in Hindu undivided family, you will be referred to as the karta, the person referred to as the karta, who is the head of the family. Even he cannot sell it unless it is for the welfare of the Hindu undivided family. In such cases, you cannot deal with the property to your likes and wishes. It has to be dealt with, that is, sold or gifted or other way dealt with, for the interest of the Hindu undivided family. So that's the basic difference between an ancestral property and self-earned property, and not what is spoken about or shown in the movies, that it's always shown, you know, my grandfather's property, I have a right. Yes, grandfather's property, you have a right only when grandfather has received it from his father and his father has received it from his father for three generations without any division. Only then you have a right. Otherwise, if a person has received a property from his father by division and thereafter succession and inheritance, it is referred to as a self-earned property and he can deal with it as he likes. So this is an introduction to what is property and what are the kinds of laws that are applicable, and whether it is testate succession or intestate succession, also known as testamentary succession and non-testamentary succession. This is the introduction to the property, kinds of laws that are applicable, kinds of properties, and kinds of succession depending on whether there is a will or no will, and according to also to the religion that the person belonged to, or the personal law that was applicable to a person who has died. And in law, we refer to him as the deceased person. Now, the second part of my presentation will be the testamentary succession. Now, testamentary succession means succession when there is a will, when the person who died, that is the deceased person, has written a will. This depends on, again, to what religion he belonged to or what was the personal law applicable to him. Fundamentally, only two differences. Testamentary succession has two divisions. One, testamentary succession applicable to Muslims and testamentary succession applicable to all others. If the person who has died is a Muslim, then Muslim law of testamentary succession will apply according to Shariat Act 1937 and the other customary laws. If you are a person belonging to any other religion, then the law applicable will be the Indian Succession Act 1925, irrespective of religion except Muslims. So let's presume that the person deceased is either a Hindu, Christian, Jain, Buddhist or Sikh, apart from a Muslim. Then the following rules will apply with regard to testamentary succession. That is, in short, to tell it in simple language, right of a person or the procedure when and how a person can make a will. Now, a will is a document which is written by a person which will come into effect obviously after his death. So he writes that how his property has to be distributed, to whom it has to be distributed after his death. Now, according to the Indian Succession Act, any person can make a will. Again, there are two kinds of wills. One is a privileged will and the other is known as the unprivileged will. The difference is, privileged will, a special procedure to a special class of persons. That is, privileged will is applicable to the members of the armed forces, that is, soldiers who are serving in the front, belonging to either army, navy or air force, and they must be in the front meaning in the war field. And then the procedure is slightly different and they are entitled to make what is known as privileged will. All others can make only unprivileged will. Even a member of the armed force, that is a soldier, in peacetime, when he is back in his hometown or when he is not posted on the borders or in warlike situations, then he also cannot make a privileged will and he has to make only an unprivileged will. So to make a privileged will, the conditions required are, you must be a member of the armed force, that is, you must be a member of either army, navy or air force, and you must be posted in the borders or you must be posted in a warlike situation, then you are entitled to make a privileged will. To all others, only unprivileged will. Now, the difference in procedure is, the unprivileged will can be oral, that is, if the person who is entitled to make a privileged will is not in a position to write it down, he can orally mention his intentions of how his property needs to be devolved or how its property needs to be distributed. If such a oral instruction is written down and thereafter he signs, it is valid. Or if he is not in a position and the doctor certifies that he is not in a position to sign, even then it is valid. Even if witnesses are not there, it is still valid. So the provision with regard to making of a privileged will is in a special situation and circumstance applicable to members of the armed forces when they are serving in the front line or near the borders. This is an exceptional situation. Now, for all others, the law applicable is law applicable to what is known as the unprivileged will, or how do you make an unprivileged will? In the normal circumstances, how do you make a will? Now, this is very important because a lot of property disputes arise because of procedures not being followed, because of a will being written in itself being a reason. Because when you write a will, normally you decide how, or the person who owns the property decides how the property should be distributed. So you do it according to your wish and desire, which the persons who are entitled to receive it, that is your legal heirs or commonly your children, may not like it. So the person or your child or a relative who is getting lesser in quantity will always be aggrieved. And because The will comes into effect after the person has died, and because the person who has died cannot come to the court and tell what was his actual intention, then the interpretation of whether it is right or wrong, whether it was rightly made or wrong, slowly depends on the document, because of which it gives rise to a lot of litigations. Hence, it is very important that a proper procedure is followed. That is, when I mean proper procedure, the procedure prescribed by law. If a procedure prescribed by law is followed in making a will, then the intention of the maker of the will, who is called as the testator, will stand still and erect, and whoever challenges it will fail. If proper procedures are not followed, if even a small doubt arises as its execution, then the will may fail. So it becomes very important that you draft it properly. Now, what the law says is, under the Indian Succession Act, the will must be in writing. That is the first requirement. Second requirement is, yes, it need not be drafted by an advocate. It can be drafted by the person making the will himself. So, in ordinary language, you can write your will. All that is required is your intention must be clear. When we say intention, what we mean is how you plan to distribute your properties. That must be very clear. If that is clear, then your will stand, and even if it is written by you, it will hold good. The third requirement is most important, is there must be two witnesses. But again, just not two witnesses, a special procedure is prescribed. Normally, any document, for example, a rental agreement or a sale agreement or a sale deed or a mortgage deed or any kind of document after execution, must be attested by two witnesses. Now, in those documents, it is enough if those two witnesses just sign and see the document. Whereas in a will, a special mode or procedure is prescribed. The special mode or procedure is that those two witnesses, either together or separately, must have actually seen the person who has written the will sign it. I will repeat, the witnesses who are attesting the will not just attest the document, but they also attest to the fact that the person who has made the will, that is the testator, has actually signed it. So the witnesses must either see the testator actually sign the will, or the testator, that is the person who is making the will, must specifically mention to the witnesses that he has signed the document and it bears his signature. So these are two requirements. That is, the witnesses must be present, must know that it has been signed by the testator, or an acknowledgement from the testator that he has actually signed it. So it is always better to have as witnesses people who are very closely known to you. Usually it is advised that one of the witnesses be your family doctor, which again will serve another purpose, wherein he can also, in case the will is challenged, certify that you are of sound mind. Or close relatives, always better close relatives. Usually what happens is, when you execute any other kind of document, you just call any two persons and ask them to witness it, and they also sign, and that is more than sufficient. But in case of a will, ensure that it is attested by two respectable persons, usually close relatives, who can vouch for you. The second caution that needs to be, or a third caution that needs to be borne in mind, is those two witnesses must not be beneficiaries under the will. That means they should not, or their immediate close relatives must not be receiving any property under the will. So for example, if you are giving your property to your daughter-in-law, then don't make your daughter-in-law's father as the witness, because close relations, and it could be the challenge could become serious. It could be any other person, but who is a close relative. Again, whether a close relative is an interested party or not depends on situation and circumstances. But definitely, if a person is receiving property under the will, that is, you have named him in your will to receive some property, he or she cannot be a witness. His or her wife or husband can also not be a witness to the will. Apart from this, any other person who knows you well can be witness to the will. But again, when you are writing a will and beneficiaries are very close relatives of the witness, avoid them. Having spoken about the requirements of preparing a will, though initially I started off saying that you can write your own will, but it is always better to have a professional draft your will. He will take care of all these procedural requirements. So have an advocate draft your will. It may cost something, but in future and in the long run, to ensure the stability and acceptability of your will, it is better that a professional drafts your will, who will take care of all the procedural requirements, all the words that need to be used to bring in clarity and certainty. Now, having said this, that the will has to be in writing. The intention of the testator, that is the person who is making the will, must be clear. And third, the requirement of witnesses. Then your will is valid. Another important requirement, though it is not mandatory, is registration of a will. Registration of a will is favored but not mandatory. That is, it is optional. If you want, you can register your will, or if you choose not to, you need not register a will. But not only mine, but any professional advice would be to have it registered. Here again, it may cost a little bit more to have it registered than having it not registered. But again, in the long run, keeping in mind the certainty and the acceptability of your will or the authenticity of your will, it is always better to have the will registered. Now, what are the advantages of registration? The advantages are very clear, and there is one specific advantage and very clear. Now, whenever a will is written, and if the devolution of property is equal among all the legal heirs, then the acceptability of will is more. But then, more often than not, what is seen is a will is written only when you change the proportionality of the devolution, that is, who should receive how much, may not be equal. That is why most of the times a will is written. Or you would want your property to go to a person who is not your legal heir. Now, a legal heir is a person who is entitled to receive your property. That we will be discussing under non-testamentary succession. In testamentary succession, a person can write a will devolving his property to whomever he likes. This being the case, so if you are writing or if you are making a person who is not your legal heir as your beneficiary, then there is bound to be some amount of heartburn among the legal heirs, and depending on the quantity of property, they may even challenge. Time and again, when we have seen wills being challenged, and the first ground for challenging of a will is that the maker of a will, that is the testator, was not of sound mind. So your legal heir will go to the extent of telling that you were not of sound mind when preparing a will. So to prevent these, to give effect to your intention, it is better to have it registered. If it is registered, what is the advantage? Now, if a will is registered, then later on, if the will is challenged, then the responsibility to prove that the will is not genuine or the will has not followed the requisite procedures is on the person who is challenging the will. If the will is not registered, then the beneficiary or the person who is receiving property under the will or who claims that the will is valid has the responsibility to prove the will. That means when you write a will and you have given properties to certain persons, and if you do not register it, the responsibility is on these persons who receive property under your will to prove the will. So the difficulty is put on the persons who are beneficiaries of the will, whereas the person who is challenging the will, all he has to do is he has to challenge the will. Then the responsibility, the onus, the hard work, everything falls on the person who is going to receive the property. So you want your property to go to someone and you don't want them to fall into hardship. Hence, it is advisable to have the will registered so that any person who is challenging the will have to prove that it is not a valid will. So it is always advisable to have the will registered. So the rules regarding making of a will, that is testamentary succession, says that it has to be in writing. The intention of the testator or the person who is making a will has to be clear. Special requirement as regarding attesting witnesses and registration, though not mandatory but advisable. So this is the law with regard to making of a will in respect to a person in India other than a Muslim, and this is governed by the Indian Succession Act. Now my third section, I will deal with how a will is made and what are the rules which are being followed or which has to be followed for Muslims. So the third part of my presentation would be testamentary succession under Muslim law. Yes, under Muslim law also, a person who is professing Islam can make a will. However, different rules are applicable. Primarily, Indian Succession Act is not applicable. And secondly, the law that is applicable is the customary Islamic law of making of a will, and the guiding law is the Shariat Act 1937. Now let's see if a person is a Muslim, how he can make a will. Now the first condition to make a will, yes, any Muslim can make a will, however, subject to the following conditions. The first condition is it can be oral or in writing. Now, unlike making of a will, unprivileged will under the Indian Succession Act, where it has to be in writing, a Muslim will known as wasiyat need not be in writing, it could be oral also. As regards its execution, there is no procedure followed. Only if the intention of the testator is made, that is enough. The second condition is, which is very important, which is very peculiar to the law of wills concerning Muslims, is that a Muslim cannot write a will with respect to his properties in its entirety. That means he cannot write a will covering all his property. he can write a will only to the extent of 1/3 of his properties. And this in law is known as bequeathable 1/3. That means a Muslim can write a will only to the extent of 1/3 of his properties. Now, the reason or the possible reason for this kind of a limitation is, if entire property is given the right to be written in a will, then there is a possibility that the testator can write his properties to any person outside the family, which will cause a lot of, number one, heartburn. Secondly, the legal heirs have a legitimate right to receive property of their ancestors. Now, this is the logical reasoning that is given for limiting the right to make a will to 1/3 of the property. So a Muslim cannot make a will beyond 1/3 of the value of his property. Third condition is, again with regard to 1/3 of the property, concerning how much and to whom it can be made. Now, even this 1/3, if you are a Sunni Muslim, then you cannot write a will to your legal heirs unless you have taken consent, or unless the consent of the legal heirs is taken. What it means is, even if the 1/3, we have said that 1/3 of the property can be willed, or 1/3 of the property can be subject matter of a will. When a Sunni Muslim makes a provision in his will for 1/3 of his property to strangers, that means here the meaning of the word stranger is someone who is not a legal heir, not literally stranger, someone who is not a legal heir, then to the extent of 1/3, the will is valid. However, if a Sunni Muslim wants to write a will to the extent of 1/3 to one or more of his legal heirs, then the will not be valid unless the consent of the other legal heirs is procured. And obviously, according to law, the requirement is the testator need not take this consent. After his death, the other legal heirs must consent, which in all probability may not happen. So the other legal heirs, only if they consent, then a will written by a Sunni Muslim to the extent of 1/3 of his property to one or more of his legal heirs, excluding others, will be valid. Now, why I use the word Sunni Muslim is because the same rule with regard to a Shia Muslim does not apply. A Shia Muslim does not have to take the consent of the legal heirs, meaning a Shia Muslim is free to write a will with regard to 1/3 of his property to whomever he wants, whether it is a stranger, that is a person or persons who are not his legal heirs, or to one or more of his legal heirs. And to the extent of 1/3, it is perfectly valid. So there is a difference of interpretation with regard to Shia law and Sunni law with regard to this 1/3 being given to legal heirs. So this is how the procedure and the law concerning wasiyat, that is a law of a Muslim, is currently there in India. So a Muslim male or any Muslim person can write a will, but only to the extent of 1/3. If the person is a Sunni, then to a stranger he can write 1/3 of his property, but if he has made his legal heirs as beneficiaries under the will, then consent of the other legal heirs is required. But if you are a Shia Muslim, then this consent of the other legal heirs is not required. Otherwise, the will need not be in writing also. It can be oral. if the intention of the testator is made known, that is more than enough. So this is with regard to making of a will by a Muslim. The next topic will be non-testamentary succession. Non-testamentary succession means where there is no will. If there is no will, then how the property devolves or how it is distributed and to whom it is distributed. Now, for the purpose of non-testamentary succession, the term legal heir becomes very important, because the legal heirs are entitled to receive the property of a deceased person. Now, legal heirs means close relatives and different classes of relatives depending on which religion you belong to. Here again, for non-testamentary succession, the rules are not the same because we do not have uniform civil code. Furthermore, depending on what religion you belong to, whether you are a Hindu, whether you are a Christian or a Parsi or a Muslim, non-testamentary succession differs according to your religion. Non-testamentary succession for Hindus is covered under the Hindu Succession Act 1956. For the Parsis and Christians, it is covered under the Indian Succession Act 1925 itself. And for Muslims, the law governing non-testamentary succession is the customary Muslim law. So, going by each of these laws, what is to be seen is how property of a person who has died intestate, now intestate means without writing a will devolve, that means distribute among his or her legal heirs depending on what religion he belonged to. So the rules are different with regard to which religion you belong to. Of course, there is no special procedure as such, but what differs is the percentage and proportion of how much property each legal heir will receive will differ. That is the only difference. Depending on which religion you belong, whether you get equal share or you get different shares is the difference in procedure with regard to non-testamentary succession. Now, first, among Hindus, the non-testamentary succession among Hindus governed by the Hindu Succession Act 1956. The only distinction is between a male and a female. Again, only a slight difference in terms of succession. If a Hindu male dies intestate, that means a male person belonging to Hindu religion dies without writing a will, then how his property will be distributed among his legal heirs? Number one. Secondly, who are his legal heirs? That is very important. Under Hindu law, more than how it is distributed, who are the legal heirs are very important, because irrespective of who is alive and who is not alive and how many legal heirs are there, under Hindu law, there is equal distribution. So if you are considered as a legal heir, then you get equal share and you share it equally among all the legal heirs, which is not so in the other three personal laws. So for example, if a Hindu male dies and if he has 5 children, and living behind his wife, if wife is surviving, wife plus 5 children, that is 6 of them, will receive or get his property equally. For that, the law prescribes what is known as class of heirs. Different classes are prescribed: class 1, class 2 and class 3. If class 1 heirs are there, then class 2 and class 3 will not get it. Only when class 1 heirs are not there, then class 2 will get it. And if class 1 and class 2 are not there, then class 3 heirs will get it. Now, generally, class 1 heirs of a Hindu male are his children, wife, and mother. Only when these people are not there, then the question of his other relatives like brothers, sisters, parents come into picture. So if a Hindu male dies intestate, first the property will go to his children, wife, and mother. If children, wife, and mother are there, then they will get equal shares. Only when these people are not there, then it goes to the other classes of heirs who are his close relatives like brothers, sisters, parents, and if they are also not there, then his cousins and other distant relatives. As regards a Hindu woman, if a Hindu woman dies intestate, having not returned a will, then first her property will go to the children and husband. If husband and children are not there, then the difference here is it will not go to her relatives, it will go to the husband's relatives, that is brothers and sisters of the husband. So if a Hindu woman dies, her property, firstly, if children and husband are there, will go to them in equal shares. If none of them are there, see, the class of heirs, even if one of them are there, then the entire property goes to them. See, for example, even if the Hindu male, I'll give you an example. If a Hindu male dies, he has one wife and three children, then the four of them will take equally. Let's presume second scenario, second example, a Hindu male dies, his wife is also dead, she has died before him, and he has only one child, then the entire property will go to that one child. Similarly, for a Hindu female, if she dies, then if children and husband are there, depending on the number of children, the shares will differ equally, but otherwise, if only husband is there and no children, the entire property will go to the husband. If husband is not there, two or three children are there, then accordingly it will go to them equally. If husband and children both are not there, then when a Hindu woman dies intestate, the property will not go to her relatives, but it will go to the husband's relatives. Only when husband's relatives are not there, then the third category of persons entitled to receive it is the parents of the women. However, this rule has a couple of exceptions. If the property is received by the woman from her parents, then the husband's relatives will not get it, and her relatives will get it if children and husband are not there. The second exception is if the wife has received property from her husband, then if children are not there, husband is not there, if husband's relatives are not there, then it will not go to her parents, but it will go to the husband's other relatives. So this is the difference. So this is how intestate succession, in brief, that happens among Hindus. Now coming to the intestate succession among Muslims, Christians, and Parsis. For the Muslims, the law applicable is the customary law of Islam. For Christians and Parsis, the law applicable for intestate succession is the Indian Succession Act. Now, to all these three people belonging to these three religions, the intestate succession and the proportion depends on how many wives and how many children and whether parents are alive, mother is alive. So all these factors have to be taken into consideration. For example, if a Muslim man dies, if he has two wives, mother and children, the rates of division are different. If he has one wife and children, the rates of division are different. If he has a mother alive, then children and wife, the rates of division are different. Now, one thing common among the Muslims, Christians and Parsis with regard to interstate succession as against the Hindus is, normally the legal heirs don't take the shares equally. A specific share is mentioned. It could be 50%, it could be 1/3, depending on who else as legal heir is alive and who else is not. For that, we need to specifically have a reference. So for each case, the rule is different. So we cannot, unlike Hindu law, tell a general rule stating that all will take it equally. So depending on whether you're a male or a female, depending on whether you have wife or husband or parents alive, how many children alive, the rates of division among your legal heirs of persons, when I say you, persons belonging to Christians, Muslims and Parsis differ. It could be half for the wife and the rest divided for the children sometimes, 1/3 and rest for the children. So it depends on who else as legal heir is alive for these three classes of, or these three religious people. And to actually judge how much a legal or what percentage a legal heir will get, we have to actually look at that specific circumstances of who else is alive and what does the law specifically tell with regard to the percentage of property that he may get. Whereas if a person is a Hindu and he has died intestate, all we have to see is whether you fall within a particular class of heirs who is entitled to inherit, and if you are within that class of heir, you take the property equally. Now, this is a brief bird's eye view, or rather an overview of the law of inheritance and succession as applicable to different persons in India. Though different laws of succession inheritance apply to different people based on their religion, there is one set of laws which has uniform application provided that law is made applicable, and that is if a person is, or if two persons get married under the Special Marriages Act, irrespective of what their religion is. I have mentioned it in the previous lecture that marriage between two persons can be solemnized under the Special Marriage Act. Usually, the jurisdiction of Special Marriage Act is invoked when parties to a marriage belong to different religions. However, it does not prevent persons belonging to the same religion getting married under the Special Marriages Act. What it means is, if a Hindu wants to marry a Muslim, or a Muslim wants to marry a Christian, or a Christian wants to marry a Hindu, then the law that would be applicable and the marriage rules that should be applicable to solemnize their marriage would be the Special Marriages Act. However, that does not mean if two Hindus want to get married under the Special Marriage Act, it is not possible. Two Hindus can get married under Special Marriage Act, or two Muslims or persons belonging to the same religion can solemnize their marriage under the Special Marriage Act. But the difference would be if persons are getting married under the Special Marriage Act, either because they belong to different religions or because, or if they are belonging to the same religion, then in case of all their personal laws, the laws, rules and procedure prescribed under the Special Marriage Act will be applicable, and their personal laws depending on their religion would cease to apply. That means when two persons get married under the Special Marriages Act, thereafter the rules of divorce, the rules of inheritance, succession will be governed by the Special Marriages Act, irrespective of whatever religion they belong to. One pertinent question arises that subsequent to a marriage of parties under the Special Marriages Act, in case of devolution of property, that is succession and inheritance, what law will be applicable? Now, if a person who is a Hindu marries a Hindu, or if a person who is a Hindu, Buddhist, Sikh, Jain marries another person who is a Hindu, Sikh, Buddhist or Jain, under the Special Marriages Act, the law governing the succession to Hindus will apply. That is, the Hindu Succession Act will apply. The Hindu Succession Act 1956 will continue to apply. This is a special exception that is provided for. In all other cases, in case if there is an interreligious marriage or persons belonging to the same religion, belonging to religions other than what is mentioned earlier, get married, then the succession according to the Indian Succession Act 1925 will be applicable. So the law of inheritance and succession that is applicable to persons who are not Hindus, if they are married under the Special Marriage Act, will be the Indian Succession Act 1925, the rules of interstate succession applicable to persons other than Parsis. Thank you very much.